Vinod, go ahead. Thank
Okay,
you.
Sir.
Good morning.
A very good morning to one and all. On behalf of the organizing committee, I welcome you all in the seventh day of 8-day online lecture series for BA Semester 2 Compulsory English, jointly organized by Dr. Madhukar Rao Vasnik, PWS College, Nagpur, Dayanand Arya Kanya Mahavidyalaya, Jaripatka, Nagpur, and Indira Gandhi Arts and Commerce College, Kalmeshwar. For today's session, we have with us Professor Mahesh Dudhe. He will be delivering his lecture on Miss Brill by Catherine Mansfield. Professor Dudhe was graduated and post-graduated from Vidarbha Mahavidyalaya Amravati, affiliated to Sant Gadge Baba Amravati University in Amravati. He cleared national eligibility test in 2005. Sir started his career as an approved lecturer in English in 2006. Later on, he joined Basantrao Naik Mahavidyalaya, Aurangabad, as an assistant professor of English in 2007. Presently, sir is working as an assistant professor of English since 2012 in Dr. Madhukar Rao Vasnik, PWS College, Nagpur. Sir has almost 14 years of teaching experience at UG and PG level. Professor Dudhe has translated an international bestseller book from English to Marathi related to personality development from the original English title, Confidence, How to Succeed at Being Yourself, authored by Dr. Alan Loy McGuinness, published by Saket Publication, Aurangabad, with the Marathi title, Atma Vishwas, Yashacha Bhakkam Paya. The areas of his special interest are psychological fiction, war poetry, literature of marginalized, meta discourse in the discipline of philosophy, and Buddhist meditative poetry. Such a scholarly personality is with us for today's session. So without taking your much of time, I invite you, sir, to deliver lecture. Over to Professor Dudhe.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Vinod, for your nice introduction this morning. A happy and warm good morning to one and all. Respected dignitaries, Honorable Principal Dr. Patik sir, faculty members from the departments of the three colleges which have made it possible to organize this lecture series, my senior colleagues, Professor Dr. Bhotesh sir, a very good friend of mine, Dr. Amol Mende, my senior companion, Dr. Ramtekim Madam, and all the other wonderful souls who are with us at this moment to enjoy this particular explanatory session. This endeavor of mine, as has been rightly mentioned by Professor Dr. Vinod Shende, is going to explicate, it's going to explain a very great work of art in the form of a short story authored by Catherine Mansfield. So the very first thing that I would like to say about Catherine Mansfield is her outstanding place, is her place of eminence in the world of literature, especially short fiction. So let's first of all get to know everything that we could about this great writer, Catherine Mansfield. In the meanwhile, I have been slightly forgetful because I forgot to make a mention of the students who have been able to join us for this specific lecture session on Miss Spring. So today we are face to face with this text of Miss Spring, authored by Catherine Mansfield. So let's start. As it is customary for us students of literature, and as admirers of great works of art, let's even at the very outset try to strike a chord inside every heart who is listening to this oration right now. So let me take you back to those days when this great lady, she was alive to make this world a better living experience through her writings. So in short, I would be, first of all, introducing Catherine Mansfield. Just let me have a single moment so that it's possible for me to share the screen.
Light should go on. कुठून केलं तुम्ही? हे झालं पहिली साईड, हे झालं
दुसरं फर्स्ट वन. आय वुड लाईक टू गो बॅक टू द फर्स्ट स्लाइड. फर्स्ट वन, दुसरं फर्स्ट वन, नो द व्हेरी फर्स्ट.
Yes.
Now everything is all right and we are ready with our presentation. Catherine Mansfield Du Chan was her complete name. I could get one nice, wonderful thought which she expressed somewhere at some point of time. So let's first of all listen to what she has to tell us. Could we change our attitude? Should not only see life difficult, but life itself would become different. That's the thought that she has to provide to us. The very first part of our presentation is an attempt to gather at least a few details about Catherine Mansfield. Catherine Mansfield Du Chan was born in Wellington, New Zealand, in a socially prestigious and prominent English family in the year 1888, which had previously immigrated in 1841 from London. It was at an early age of 19 that she went to London to study music. Here, one thing I need to mention, and It is that she wanted to become a cellist. She wanted to learn how to play on this particular musical instrument, a cell. But this deeply felt wish of hers remained unfulfilled. And instead, she went on to attend university. She joined a great college, Queen's College, London. After spending some time in England, she returned to New Zealand for some time. She felt like visiting her country of birth, New Zealand. But even before that, she completed a tour of continental Europe. And after arriving back to her country, she began writing fiction seriously from the year 1906. She had also another side to her genius and personality. For a short duration, she was at the helm of affairs as someone who was associated with a school newspaper and contributed to that prominent school newspaper and even became its editor. But the life in the city of London, upon reflection, appeared to her to be very endearing. And she had her yearnings to go back to London. And she took it, what she back to London in the year 1908. Thereafter, she spent the rest of her life as a writer in England. Fortunately for her, she could begin by grooming herself in the world-famous short stories of the Russian master Anton Chekhov. Now she was there in London and the life in the city of London was so very fascinating for her, because the then contemporary London was artistically very a place of dominance. Place of importance. So she felt that it's a good place where art and literature and other such yearnings for on the part of anyone could be fulfilled to a great extent. So
Abol, what happened? Amol, are you hearing me? Amol, are you hearing me?
Sir, he got disconnected.
Okay.
No, no, we can't hear
you. He has disconnected. He is completely disconnected. I wonder as to who has given Zoom link to students. Because I only used to give YouTube links to students. Students are joining here. They are supposed to join. They are supposed to join YouTube and leave their comments there. Shweta, Sanket, Najreen, Lakshmi Dongre, Ishika Jaiswal, Ajiti Kudwe, please, you can leave Zoom and join YouTube. Because your presence will be there forever. Students, are you listening to me?
Have you got the YouTube link?
Yes, you people have to join YouTube because on YouTube, your comments will be there always.
Sudesh, sir.
Hi, yes, yes.
Now it is connected.
Yours is connected.
No,
he is not. Another device is not connected.
Okay, just a minute.
It must
be.
I'm just rejoining him.
Okay. Okay, now switch on the camera and share the screen.
पहले उसको लाना पड़ेगा, उसको ब्लैक पे लाना पड़ेगा।
Hello. Yes. Now we are able to resume our session. just a while ago. We learned about Catherine Mansfield's earlier attempts at trying to take her lessons in the field of writing fiction. So she made a very intelligent choice by going through the world famous short stories of the Russian short story writer Anton Chekhov. Another thing which strikes us particularly is that throughout her life, she was constantly plagued by ill health. And the span of her life itself was very short. But her husband was there to take care of her. And it was because of the loving care and attention of her husband, John Middleton Murray, that she could convince herself and get supported in every sense. Now this man, John Middleton Murray, he was at that time a very famous editor and critic. Famous English editor and critic. So he always encouraged Mansfield to carry on with her endeavors to write with confidence. And he was there as a constant companion to support her morally. One thing which makes us sad about Catherine Mansfield is that she passed away prematurely at the age of 33 of tuberculosis, which is also known as the illness of consumption. So it was in 1923 that she left her world of human beings to be a part of her heavenly abode. As she breathed her last in Fontainebleau, a region in France, in the year of 1923. Let us at the second place now take a look at a prominent works, the bulk of her writings, on the basis of which we are able to understand Catherine Mansfield for what she really is. Whatever she wrote is a substantial body of her works, which is part of her literary output. And it includes quite a few names. Let's enumerate the names of these works of art that she penned. Her very first volume of short fiction was entitled In a German Pension. And the year when it came out was 1911. Another major collection with the name Bliss and Other Stories came out in the year 1920. And this collection firmly established her reputation as a brilliant writer of short fiction. So she could ground herself properly in the world of fiction writing. After that,
just let it be.
Next one. The third important volume of her collection of stories was named The Garden Party. And this collection included the present story in this print. It was just 1 year before her death that this collection of short stories came out in the year 1922. The Dove's Nest was the next major achievement and got published in 1923. If we look at the bulk of her writings, it is possible for us to say that she wrote in all 88 wonderful stories of rare excellence and insight, out of which 15 remained unfinished to the last. We have been able to gather a sizable amount of information about Catherine Mansfield as a novice in the field of fiction writing. But interestingly, she never even made an attempt at writing a novel. We would find it very surprising. All her unpublished writings, including her letters and journals, could appear in print only after her untimely and sad demise. So the world could come to know about her place of eminence in the world of literature only after her passing away. There was an individuality that she always exuded wherever she was and whoever she met and whatever she wrote. Through all these experiences, she could make it very clear that she has a different take on things. She has a way of, she has her own way of looking at the world and life. So her individual mark of rare distinction as a giant storyteller, as a giant of a short story writer, we have to understand this aspect of her genius. All her stories are memorable as finely crafted stories. And through her stories, she honestly seeks to explore the inner workings of the human mind, to get to the innermost depths of human mind. And she could do this with a remarkable insight and understanding, even to those deeper places and cores of emotions where it's possible to find the slightest of emotions, which are not commonly discovered and felt by others. Her stories are remarkable for her mastery, perfect mastery over the medium of the short story. And there is an image, there is a countenance, face of Catherine Mansfield that we are able to look at, to realize. And so far as style is concerned, and the act of composition is concerned, we are able to feel it deeply that she has got a rare craftsmanship as a short story writer. While talking about Mansfield, Catherine Mansfield Liu Chan, it's also equally important for us to learn about her influences, all those great writers who could teach her good many things about fiction writing, about literature, about human experience and authorship. So let's learn about the great writers who influenced her authorship and genius. You are going to find at least a few names of some of these great and world famous writers who shaped her outlook and writings. The very first name is almost well known to every single student of literature and what we call literary creation. And this man was the celebrated Russian master Fyodor Dostoevsky. After that, we come across D.H. Lawrence. He's known for some of his great novels like Rainbow, Women in Love, Lady Chatterley's Lover, and Sons and Lovers. So this man was also one of the influences. And some of his epoch-making novels she must have read and gone through. And that is how she could take another, she could receive few other lessons in the craft of short fiction writing. Anton Chekhov, as I already told you, was one of her best preferences as a writer of short stories. And throughout her career of writing, this man Anton Chekhov was a very powerful influence on her genius. A remarkable salient feature found in the writings of all these great influences of Catherine Mansfield is a specific mode through which they wrote. And it was in the realist mode that all these writers wrote whatever they had to write. The foremost concern of these writers was to portray the human world as it is apparent to us, as it is seen by us. But at the same time, it also especially valued these writers. They also respected the idea that the plot should naturally arise from situation and character. So this has to serve as a basis for literary creation, especially the birth of a short story, if at all it has to justify itself as a good story. It should arise out of two things, plot and character. And Catherine Mansfield, very honestly, and with almost a devout sense of worshiper, she followed this ideal even to her last breath. And to that final year when she had unfortunately to settle down her pain and to withdraw from the field of writing. The universally lyrical and realistic short stories of another adorable Irishman, whose name is known to all of us, James Joyce. Once we take his name, we are immediately reminded of the portrait of the artist as a young man and a few other great works of art which he brought out. So this man, an Irishman, James Joyce, was also one of the influences. And his stories were realistic and lyrical. So this quality of lyricism was something very attractive. And we can, to a reasonable extent, say that this man was also probably one of her literary influences. Before going into the details of the story, Miss Brill, it's quite worth doing that we should familiarize ourselves of or context of the story, Miss Brill. Now, the name of the story itself is really very captivating, very endearing. It fascinates us because it's the name of a person that has been given to the story. And after reading the title of the story, we could perhaps commit a mistake of not taking it seriously, but we have to. Because going by the name, which is a short name and the special name of somebody, it would be a grave mistake. So let's learn something about the historical background, backdrop or context of this story, Miss Brill. The First World War. And whatever scenario prevailed in some of the major nations throughout our human world. So it was immediately after witnessing the terrible, horrible and destabilizing ravages left behind by the First World War that Catherine Mansfield has visualized this story in this spring has taken place. So we have to associate this story with the country France. How was it like in those days when the First World War had come to an end? And there was this same feeling of disillusionment and getting disconnected from our routines, our moorings. First of all, it's necessary to say something about the setting of the story, and it's very clearly France, which was under the influence of the after effects of the First World War. As a natural outcome, there was a phenomenal increase in the number of wealthy people in certain elite sections of society. And a new well-to-do, prosperous class of wealthy people had emerged after the war was over. And with it, there was a lot of excitement, fun, and the spirit of enthusiasm. There was this band of musicians, boisterous, celebrating annual festivities and having get-togethers and parties. In the story itself, one reference is there to the season. It has been capitalized. And the particular connection this word season has is to the emergence of this well-to-do, prosperous class of wealthy people who wanted to celebrate whatever they could enjoy, whatever place of importance they could gain after this First World War was over. As a piece of writing this story, Miss Brill is brimful. It overflows with fine, excellent descriptions of new love and young children. The story takes us to a public park in France, and there you get to see so many different people. And the description includes many different things here in the form of love relationships, youngsters coming together, young children, they would like to play on the grass in the company of their near and dear ones and would like to enjoy themselves. On the other hand, there was also the older generation of elderly people in the society. And in this story, this older generation of people, such people, they appear to be exhausted, fatigued, to a great extent, possibly partially because of the excruciating, very painful and unbearable after effects, consequences of the First World War that unfortunately the world had to suffer from, to endure. That war was something which took place in the year 1914, and it continued up to the year 1918. So this was a major shock which had shaken the very roots of everyone's life. Now let us get on, let us move on to the next part of our presentation, which is all about the summary of the story. We need to take a quick look at how many different incidents and threads of meaning run concurrently through this story. So let's learn about the story. Every Sunday, this woman, Miss Brill, visits the French public park, which has been mentioned in the story as Jardins Publics, by always putting on her shabby old fur coat made up of short, fine, and soft animal hair. But it is very dear to us, her, very close to her heart. And whenever she has to go to the public park, she would take out her old fur coat, put it on, and go there with an expectation to see something and to derive her own sense of meaningfulness in her life. Even in the very beginning of the story, while narrating this, we are told that Miss Brill starts speaking to her fur coat as if speaking to another living person. Perhaps we may have a feeling that she has gone crazy or something is wrong with her, but actually it is not. This unusual act by Miss Brill clearly indicates, it shows her pitiable state of loneliness, alienation, and utter sense of despair. Because as she was by herself, she was alone, and visiting the public park was her only means of deriving some pleasure and getting her own boosters to be able to survive happily. Now, at this juncture, the annual period described as the season of parties, balls, and charity events, especially organized by elite people, this celebration has begun. The season has begun. And it's a very special social celebration where everyone would like to be present there, would like to attend it, and thus they could derive an enjoyment which was necessary, because those were the years when the war was over and people had to come back to square one. They had to get back to the normal routine. So the season began, and one day, Miss Brill, while seated inside the park, this park in France, in the stands where there are these places for the onlookers and the people who are going to listen to the music band. So that place is known as the stands. She is seated inside the park in the stands, and from there she watches and observes and listens to the band playing music. The band has started playing music, and some of these people are enjoying listening to music. And she also notices the other people who sit around her, those who are sitting quite close to her, and a few others who are playing on the grass nearby. She could also notice a few kids playing on the grass. But what happens is, she is fascinated by everything that is happening all around her. The sights and glimpses, everything she sees and overhears.
It goes on to fascinate her, attract her greatly. She becomes curious to eavesdrop. That means to overhear what others are doing. What are they saying? What is the subject of their conversation? Because for Miss Brill, she has got this as her only choice. She finds herself lonely and alienated and full of despair. That's why going to the park and listening to what others are doing and others are saying is her only source of pleasure. So she is impatient and curious to overhear the conversations which are done by other people. And she would also like to take care that no one is able to see that she is listening to what they are saying. Let us proceed further. On a particular Sunday, during a particular week, a fine old man and a big old woman, two people who are seated near her, she is able to see that why these two elderly people not saying anything, not talking, not holding a conversation. So she gets amused and she happens to see these two people. She feels that all the people present in the stands, passages and enclosures with her all look kind of the same. Whichever face she notices, the same kind of gestures, the same color she is able to see. All people look kind of the same. There is no difference that she is able to notice. All of them appear to be odd, silent, and nearly alike, all old. So she doesn't find any enjoyment, doesn't find any substance in whatever people are doing and talking about. Nonetheless, Miss Brill's eavesdropping or overhearing continues. She continues it because she won't like to return back home too early. And after some time, she happens to notice a gentleman in gray, in a dress which is of gray color, and a woman. And this woman is to be identified by the clothes she has put on, her clothing. She has been mentioned as an ermine top. This is a French expression for a small woman's hat which is of white color. So she has not been described in terms of a human being or a person. Instead, the writer has described her with the help of the image of this small hat that she had put on. This woman is there and Miss Brill happens to see her. She listens to their small talk and wonders what they might say. Ye do log wahan par hain, ye kya baat karenge? कौन सा विषय छेड़ने वाले होंगे? What is going to happen next? She feels very impatient to learn this. And she also has a feeling that this woman with her small white hat on her head looks very shabby. She doesn't look nice. So this is her impression. However, Miss Brill remains unsatisfied. She couldn't derive any pleasure by remaining in the park for some time more. And all of a sudden, these two people, they go away. They go to some other place. And it is against her expectations. Because she has been expecting that something meaningful or interesting should have transpired or taken place. But she couldn't see anything like that happening. And those two people, they went away. And she feels disappointed. Then immediately after a single moment, she notices an old man who almost gets knocked down. He stumbles while he is walking ahead. A few young girls, they give a jerk to him and he falls down. But these girls are not aware of the thing that they have disturbed the old man walking slowly. He is infirm. He is a weaker person and they disturbed him and he fell down. So she sees this. Miss Prill starts wondering how fascinating this eavesdropping of mine is. I have been overhearing the conversations of people over a long period of time, every Sunday, every week. So this is really very fascinating, even to me. And she starts imagining, developing her own theory of what these all surroundings convey to her. She has a theory that everyone and all who are present there in the park, as if they are all actors and players on stage. It's a grand play and we are all actors. This is a play going on and everyone has an important role to play. And she also believes that she has also been assigned a particular role to play in this play. And she must execute it. She must never fail in coming to the park, because if she does this, she would be missing a great opportunity and shall have to remain at home and to get herself locked inside the four walls of her residence. So she would like to come here every next week and Sunday and would like to be play her role in this play. And she must observe that she does this very carefully. Now, one of the facts revealed in the story has to do with her routine as an individual, as a woman. She spent her days as a teacher for children, बच्चों को सिखाना पढ़ाना, and also during her spare time as a reader for an old man who hardly ever recognized her existence and presence while she was busy reading out newspapers to him, especially when she went to the public park and this old man came there and demanded that she could be reading something out of the newspapers. So as long as she read out the newspaper to him, that person could not recognize, that old man could not recognize that Miss Brill is sitting next to me and I should be holding a dialogue with her. I should be asking her something. He doesn't pay any attention to her. And does Miss Brill feels that she is neglected? He doesn't recognize her presence. So this is another source of disappointment and you see, loneliness for Miss Brill. And now she comes out with a solution. She has to find a way out of this pool of hot water, a situation of difficulty. So she thinks of the possibility of reminding this man. I must be telling him very loudly that I am someone and I am near him. So she says to him in a loud voice, I have been an actress for a long, long time, my dear old man. I'm near you and I want to tell you that I have been an actress up to the present time and you have not been caring enough to notice my presence. This is not fair. So Miss Brill always had one habit which she observed. Whenever she went to the park, she had one special seat reserved for her. She won't allow others to occupy that seat. She always fixed a particular seat and a bench where she would like to sit. And every Sunday she went there and sat in the same, you see, place. It was only last week that when she was there in the same park, that she had seen an English man and his wife, a couple, a married couple was there. They had come to, you see, enjoy the celebrations. They wanted to listen to the band playing music. So they had had a very dull argument. They started talking, and when Miss Brill could listen to their conversation, she thought that it's a very dull argument, very dry and insipid kind of conversation. And what is this woman talking about, the wife of the English man? She starts talking about the glasses, spectacles. During this prattle or babble, meaningless talk, unnecessary talk, Miss Brill wanted to approach this woman and shake her vigorously. Unko laga ki mujhe uske kareeb jana chahiye aur use pakad kar hilana chahiye. She is being very silly because for sometimes she has been talking only about glasses and spectacles. She should have put an end to this conversation, which is very silly, because no spectacles of bring to her any spectacle, any glasses, she won't be pleased with that particular thing. And her husband tried to convince her, all right, we would be getting other spectacles, and we would be preferring whatever you want to have. We would be fixing something else, but she is not happy. She doesn't get pleased with whatever her husband would be getting for her. And that is why, after wasting a few minutes, they are unhappy. And Miss Brill is even more unhappy, because this has been a sheer waste of time. Another picture, another slice of life, another, I would like to say, vignette, a small picture. In the scheme of things, which is the story, Miss Brill. After some time, she saw one boy and a girl, youngsters. A boy came, and he was accompanied by a girl, who came together and sat in the stands. वहाँ जहाँ Miss Brill बैठी थी, वहाँ आकर वे stands में या जो listeners हैं, उनके लिए जो passage है, वहाँ आकर बैठ जाए. And they occupied the same seat which was earlier used by the fine old man and the big old woman. सबसे पहले जिन दो लोगों को देखा था Miss Brill ने पार्क में, तो उनकी जगह वहां पर पार्क में जहां वे बैठे थे, ठीक उसी जगह जाकर जहां से वे चले गए थे, वहां जाकर ये लड़का और लड़की बैठ जाते आराम से. And now Miss Brill is there at a distance, and she grows curious. What is going to happen, and why are both of these youngsters there, and to do what? So she becomes impatient to learn, because it would be her slice of life, her you see only means of getting some pleasure and killing her time. Both the boy and the girl appear to be wealthy. They appear to be belonging to financially prosperous families. And they also appear to be in love. Miss Brill ko lagta hai ki ye dono youngsters hai, shayad pyar karne wale panchi hai, ya premijan hai. But after closer observation, kareeb se dekhne ke baad, madam ko samajh mein aa jata hai ki these two youngsters of the same age, perhaps they are in the middle of an argument of sorts. Kisi tarah ki koi anban hai ya baat banti nahi hai ya nahi ban rahi hai. Are park mein aane ke baad bhi achhi jagah, sundar jagah, music hai, sare log hai, bacche khel rahe hain, to yahan aane ke baad bhi unhe space nahi mil pa raha hai youngster, because they have come to the park to have a good time in the company of each other as new lovebirds. They would like to be in a relationship, and they would like to improve their you see rapport. But unfortunately, while so many people are there in the park, they don't get any corner. and silence and a sense of relaxation, because they find whatever is happening there to be very disturbing. They don't get a space. Now, after a while, the boy and the girl notices, they notice Miss Brill sitting in one corner. And they start complaining, wondering aloud, why anyone like Miss Brill, this old woman, was present in that park at all at that time. The youngsters have a feeling that the park must be entirely left to us youngsters, where no old people would be coming, and we won't have time to express our love. We won't have spaces to advance further in the relationship of love. So the boy complains that why is this woman, Miss Brill, is present in the park? At this time, she should be at home, and we are getting disturbed. Who could have desired her presence there at that time? So the boy feels that nobody in the park could have expected or desired that this old woman, Miss Brill, should be present here in the park. While conversing with the girl and talking to the girl, the boy calls Miss Brill that stupid old thing. They say, ye purani murk cheese. Is tarah se wo kya karta hai, dosh deta hai. Ya phir usse adchan hoti hai. Isliye wo is tarah se kya karta hai. A term of abuse, of course, describes her face as a silly old mug. Ye purana, jaise mug kehte hain hum, bahut hi bekar sa, या फिर जो इस्तेमाल से बाहर हो गया, ऐसा कोई पुराना, यस, टूटा फूटा पुराना बर्तन. लेकिन इंग्लिश में इसे स्लैंग कहा जाता है, अ स्लैंग एक्सप्रेशन फॉर अ पर्सन्स अनडिजायरेबल एंड अगली फेस विच इज नॉट यू सी एंजॉयड बाय अदर्स, विच इज नॉट यू सी अ गुड साइट टू लुक एट व्हेन अदर्स आर देयर. So the boy calls her face as a silly old mug, which is nauseating to him, because he is not able to enjoy the company of his sweetheart. The girl also makes fun of Miss Brill's fur coat. Use pronounce karte samay use extend karti hai, jaise hum mazak udate hain auron ka, ki itna purana, kitne saalon pehle ka ye fur coat hai, aur bar bar har Sunday isi ko pehen kar madam aati hai. तो वो लड़की मजाक में उड़ाती है इस बात को कि ये क्या पहनकर आई है ये बूढ़ी औरत. As something very funny, she describes the old fur coat as something very funny and starts giggling, जोरों से हंसने लगती है. She describes Miss Brill's fur coat in negative, obnoxious terms. मतलब जैसे हम दोष ढूंढते हैं, ऐप ढूंढते हैं, या फिर गलती निकालते हैं, हमें अच्छा नहीं लगता देखना. तो शी स्टार्ट्स मेकिंग फन ऑफ दिस ओल्ड फर कोट एंड शी फाइंड्स इट यू सी ऑब्नॉक्सियस, अच्छा नहीं लगता. टू हर इट अपीयर्स एग्जैक्टली लाइक अ फ्राइड वाइटिंग, जैसे कैसे आपके किचन में पकाया हुआ गरम गरम सा कोई कुक्ड फिश वाइटिंग, इस तरह से उसका चेहरा मुझे लगता है, नजर आता है. ऐसा भी इस लड़की ने उस समय क्या कहा, मन ही मन में अलाउड थिंकिंग चल रहा है. तो दोनों आपस में बात कर रहे हैं और दूरी पर मिस ब्रिल है. इस तरह से एक क्या होता है, एक इंसल्टिंग एक सिलसिला शुरू हो जाता है, क्योंकि यंगस्टर्स दे वुड लाइक टू सी ओल्डर पीपल इनसाइड द पार्क. So fed up of these surroundings, now it's late in the evening, and Miss Brill grows fed up of these unproductive surroundings. She hasn't been able to derive any pleasure, and she hasn't gained anything throughout the time that she had already spent there. So she gets fed up of these surroundings and people and unusual actions and movements of various people, and she finally takes a decision to get back home. She leaves for her home. That particular day was a Sunday while returning home, she didn't go to that particular bakery to purchase her usual slice of honey cake. It was habitual with Miss Brill that every Sunday when she was to return from the park, she would visit the bakery and get her slice of honey cake. But this time, this Sunday, she didn't even think of bothering to go to the bakery and get this slice of honey cake. She felt very disappointed. After reaching her home, she once again would like to put that old fur coat back into its box, which is there in some corner of some room. So she again puts her old fur coat inside its proper box. And while doing this, she doesn't even care to look at her dear old fur coat. Now we may understand why this kind of disengagement, this kind of, you see, disconnectedness is there in the action of Miss Brill. But when she put the lid of the box on, she thought she heard something crying. Ye hamari kahani ka aakhri sentence hai. When she put the lid of the box on, she felt she heard something crying. मतलब कहीं से कोई रोने की आवाज आ रही है, ऐसा उनको भ्रम होता है, आभास होता है. It is a kind of a hallucination, something which she feels. Is someone crying in some corner or at a distance? She feels it. Now let us proceed to the concluding part of the story and let's derive some kind of an important essence of the story as best as we could. Now this story, Miss Brill, is very popular in the field of short fiction, and there are reasons why it is so very popular. Partly because of its use of the great stream of consciousness technique and mode of narration, stream of consciousness. And this was the mode in which Miss Brill's character gets revealed through her thoughts about others as she watches a crowd from a public park bench. Is kahani mein jis tarah se Miss Brill ka character hamare samne उजागर होता है, खुलता है या स्पष्ट होता है, मोड के माध्यम से किया जा चुका है, स्ट्रीम ऑफ कॉन्शियसनेस टेक्निक, साइकोलॉजिकल नॉवेल का जो ये होता है, साधन होता है नरेशन. एंड व्हाइल शी ऑब्जर्व्स अ क्राउड ऑफ पीपल फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस इन अ पब्लिक पार्क, दिस टेक्निक ऑफ स्ट्रीम ऑफ कॉन्शियसनेस हैज बीन एक्सीलेंटली एंड क्लेवरली एम्प्लॉयड बाय Catherine Mansfield Beauchamp. She is a master at doing this. And she had her great giant masters who taught her how to make use of this mode of narration, stream of consciousness. We may even get reminded of another great lady, her name, Virginia Woolf, a great lady, to the lighthouse. And the Mrs. Dalloway. These are great works of art. And Mansfield could learn a lot from such people and writers. What is even more striking in this story is that Miss Brill, this woman, keeps thinking of herself, her own life all the time. You take her anywhere. You ask her to remain at home. You invite her to attend a party, but she would be the same woman. She all the time from inside, she is busy thinking about herself. Although she is in the company of others, there are surroundings which expect her presence. She is not able to contribute. And inside, she feels thinking, she keeps thinking about herself and her emotions and feelings and state of mind and whatever kind of loneliness she has to undergo. She is very busy in doing this, yet taken together or in its completeness, this story delineates, it picturizes one of the most complete and succinct character sketches in the realm of 20th century short fiction. जिस प्रदेश को, जिस डोमेन को हम 20th सेंचुरी शॉर्ट फिक्शन कहते हैं, उस प्रदेश में या उस दुनिया में अगर कुछ मेजर पड़ाव हैं या माइलस्टोन्स हैं, तो उनमें से एक ये कहानी हो सकती है, जिस तरह का कैरेक्टर स्केच इसमें अच्छी तरह से दर्शाया है या तराशा है. नाउ द फाइनल सेंटेंस ऑफ द स्टोरी अप्रोप्रिएटली कन्वेज द प्लाइट ऑफ अ वुमन, एक महिला की दुर्दशा या फिर बुरा हाल, मिजरेबल कंडीशन. मिस ब्रिल इज दैट वुमन हु इज प्रोफाउंडली लैकिंग इन राइट सेल्फ अवेयरनेस. मतलब किसी भी इंसान में, चाहे वो दुनिया में कहीं भी हो, चाहे जितने और अलग 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 लोगों के समुदाय में हो, अपना खुद का सेल्फ अवेयरनेस, ये इसमें कमी नहीं आनी चाहिए या इसमें किसी तरह की गिरावट नहीं होनी चाहिए. लेकिन मिस ब्रिल ये नहीं कर पाती. शी प्रोफाउंडली लैक्स इन दिस यू सी एट्रीब्यूट ऑफ मेंटेनिंग राइट काइंड ऑफ सेल्फ अवेयरनेस. शी लूजेस कॉन्टैक्ट विथ हर सेल्फ अवेयरनेस. And the story also tells us about an elderly female character, Miss Brill, namely, who would do everything to get herself distracted. She is ready to distract herself from her own miserable sense of insignificance. There is no importance that she is able to attach to her own existence and state of being. So she feels that she is very insignificant. But to run away or to escape from this sense of insignificance, she would like to do anything. She would like to go to the public park every Sunday. And lack of meaningful relations. Matlab, there is no other way where she could spend her time more meaningfully and productively, profitably. So she would like to distract herself. In trying to forget her own sense of insignificance and lack of meaningful relations in her own personal life. And that is exactly what is suggested through this phrase, which appears in the sentence, Miss Brill heard something crying. So that is the final sentence and the meaning which has been implied. When Catherine Mansfield could, crystallize the sordid experience of Miss Brill by making use of such an excellent sentence. So that's it. And the presentation is over here. Thank you so much for lending to me your patient ears and your willingness to be with me in this enterprise of trying to understand Catherine, a great short story writer, Catherine Mansfield Du Chan. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Badiya.
Thank you, one and all.
Hello, friends. I take this opportunity to propose the formal vote of thanks for this session. First of all, I extend my heartfelt thanks to my friend, Professor Mahesh Dure, sir, for delivering a wonderful speech. I assure you, sir, that your today's deliberation will definitely benefit the students. I am also thankful to all the principals of three colleges for their guidance and support. I extend my deep sense of gratitude to all the members of the organizing committee for their continuous efforts to make the lecture series a success. I fail in my duty if I don't mention the actual focus of this lecture series, that is our student. I'm very much thankful to all the students of BA Second Sem for their online presence. Thank you very much, sir. Sudesh sir.
Yes.
Is there any announcement for tomorrow's session?
Yes, please.
Okay. I have an announcement for tomorrow's session. Tomorrow, we will have Dr. Chetana Pathak, Associate Professor, Dayanand Arya Kanya Mahavidyalaya, Jaripatka, Nagpur, as a resource person. He will be delivering the lecture on the poem Stay Calm by Grenville Glaser and The Lotus by Toru Dutt. And with the permission of chair, I hereby declare that the session is over.
Okay, thank you all.
Sir, timing?
9:30.
Sudesh sir, what is the timing of tomorrow's session?